You are sitting in front of an abuser and you want to help this person practically. Where would you go? What would you say? What would you do? We're going to talk about helping an abuser to transform, practically speaking, in this episode. Hello, everyone. Rick Thomas here. I'm with my friend Daniel Berger. We're doing Life Over Coffee. We're putting together a series of videos about biblical counseling on some very relevant topics. The last two videos, we talked about victim and victimology. And Daniel and I were talking and we said, hey, let's just push this just a little bit farther, but let's move over from the victim side to talk about how do you help someone who is the abuser? And so, Daniel, that's the question that I'm asking you right now.
Yeah. Well, I think as we've discussed, even in the videos, what we have to do is take out our biblical lens. So the whole idea of abuser, you know, the world is so good about creating these labels that kind of even distract us from understanding things biblically. Even thinking just off the top of my head here, as we talked about this, the whole idea of narcissism, right? Another great secular label that many people use to describe someone who abuses other people. And so what we're doing is we're saying, what are they describing? Because again, this is at the core in secularism, it's going to be descriptive psychology.
Right.
And of course, scripture describes these same tendencies, these same behaviors, these same heart pursuits and phenomena, if you would. And so one of the places that I like to go is Philippians chapter 2. It talks about, and let me just say this, narcissism and an abuser is actually not an abnormality. Unfortunately, it's who we are naturally. We often, and secularists again, are excellent at doing this. Anything that doesn't fit into their evolutionary narrative, they just label and categorize as abnormal or disordered. So if they can't explain it, then they create this label. And so narcissism, an abuser, if you would, these are examples of that. And so scripture is very clear in Philippians 2 that the natural man has two major problems. There's you know, many others from this. Besides our weakness, specifically talking about our wickedness, there's two problems within our wickedness, or depravity, as we often right. call it in theological terms. And the two are specifically, God says that we're to have the mind of Christ, which is going to produce unity. In chapter 1, it was about suffering. And then in chapter 2, he says, you need to put off two things, selfish ambition and pride. And so when we talk about a narcissist or we talk about an abuser, what we're really talking about is the natural man, but we're seeing it so blatantly that it's repulsive to us.
Right.
We don't often see it when it's ourselves, but when it's so blatant, we kind of want to dissociate from it. We want to distance ourselves from that natural man.
And okay, so let me, as we're building these building blocks here, we have an abuser that's in front of us. Now we have one or two directions we can go. If we go the secular path, they're going to say this is abnormal behavior, and then they're going to give a prescription, which probably would lead to some form of medication. All right, so we have an abuser sitting in front of us. We're going to take them down a biblical path. We're saying this is not abnormal behavior, but this is normal behavior. So we're starting in a whole different spot. And so now, rather than treating this as a disorder, as an abnormality, we can actually give them biblical hope through the practical application of Christ. Now, you're in Philippians 2. You're talking about the mind of Christ. So right. I think I know where you're going here. This is a whole different mindset. This is an ever-increasing disorderedness that never leads to the mind of Christ. This is orderedness that leads to the mind of Christ. Is this where you're going?
That's right.
All right, so you've got this person, narcissistic, abuser, selfish ambition, pride, and where do you want to take him? Now that we've identified and we have him going down the right path, what do you want to do with him?
Yeah, and I'll, or her
for that matter.
And I'll just quickly add to that too. It's not just limited to these secular categories, if
right.
you would. Even in what they call mania within the bipolar construct, you have the DSM-5 actually says that the key feature in mania is too high self-esteem. Same with borderline personality disorder, which is ironically, talk about descriptive psychology, it's on the border, if you would, of being either psychotic or bipolar. And of course, those are really not different things, or schizophrenic and bipolar. And so it literally is labeled as or borderline because it's on the border. But the features are self-absorption, they're selfish ambition, if you would, and many times too high self-esteem or grandiose delusions of grandeur. So all of this, you know, goes back to that. So if we're to have the mind of Christ, well, again, we're setting this up to be what is normal, right? So the world is saying normal is we are loving and gracious towards each other. That's what normal people do. Christ is saying, no, our problem is that we're all full of pride. We see that, again, going back to Genesis chapter 3. And even before then, Satan went before the throne, had the first delusion of grandeur or psychosis, really. It was delusional thinking that he was like the Most High God.
Yeah, and I think that's important because they're saying that we have inherent goodness.
Right.
Therefore, if we're not acting out from inherent goodness, we have a disorder.
Right.
We're saying we're just broken inside. You used the word earlier, total depravity. That is our starting point.
Right.
Therefore, when we act out, that's kind of expected,
that's
which
right.
is why we need another person.
That's exactly right. And that is key as we counsel. So if I'm a secular counselor and you're the biblical counselor, I'm going to try to bring him back to a goodness within himself, because again, that's my starting point, versus biblically, it's got to be a supernatural transformation requiring repentance, requiring the Holy Spirit's work of repentance.
Right, and the best that he could do is just turn over new leaves, find 7 effective habits that work, but none of that is sustainable because only Christ can sustain in true regeneration and ongoing
That's
sanctification
right.
transformation.
That's exactly right. And so we're looking at Christ as the changer, if you would, the sanctifier. And so that starting point of not just the label, but the understanding of,
right.
of and even further than that, again, to I think we mentioned this in a previous video, the whole idea of biodeterminism. Once an abuser, always an abuser, right? Once an alcoholic, always an alcoholic. Well, evidence is clear that that's not the case. When Christ changes someone, they are changed.
Right.
That doesn't mean that we all don't struggle with selfish ambition and pride. And that's a very good point, I guess, to park on a second, too, is in Romans chapter 12, where it talks about our reasonable worship is to present our bodies as a living sacrifice, right? And a lot of what we call abuse, whether it's a father with a child, whether it's a spouse with a wife, whether it's a boss or, you know, et cetera, wherever that is taking place is often carried out in the body. So we're looking at that as a living sacrifice. Well, one of the first things he says that you present yourself as a living sacrifice, it's the transforming of the mind. And the very first thing he addresses is that you not think too highly of yourself, right? So this is a Christian problem just as much as it is the world's
right.
problem. This is
right.
our problem.
Right.
This is our root problem, is that we want to be like the Most High. And so just like Eve, when Satan came along and said, do you want to be like God? This is we're constantly thinking we're God. We're pursuing our own idols. We're pursuing our own selfish ambitions and thinking highly of ourselves. So again, that normal is essential for what direction we take these people. And as you know, and you can maybe talk about even more, we're not trying to change people.
Right.
We're letting the Holy Spirit work in their life. We're presenting truth that sets them free, and it's the Word of God that produces faith, according to Romans.
Yeah, and I think all of us disciple makers need to keep reminding ourselves of that. As Paul
right.
said, Corinthians 3:6, we water, we plant. God is the one that brings the growth, because part of the problem as far as a soul care provider is that we can quickly disqualify ourselves because we can feel the pressure to change this person.
Sure.
But that is not our call to do that. We just want to be faithful ministers of the word, but yet we want to do it with theological precision.
Right.
We want to do it practically.
Yep.
So we want to be good ministers of the word.
Yeah, and as you just said, when I'm sure you remember back when you first started counseling, we had genuine desire to help people and to
right.
have a good product, if you would, right? But many times our flesh in itself, because of that selfish ambition, even
right.
in counseling someone, we're desiring an outcome because it would make us look good, at
right.
least in our minds, right?
Right.
And so we've got to even as counselors let go of that and realize, you know, number one, we're not in control of someone changing. It's the Holy Spirit. Our job is to faithfully present the Word of God so that the
right.
Spirit can do His work. And of course, that requires us to be walking with the Spirit, right?
Right.
Galatians 6 talks about this. If you're filled with the Spirit, literally controlled by the Spirit, then you can restore others. It's not we're the ones restoring, it's the Spirit's work through us.
So. All right, so we're in Philippians 2, verse 1, and we're moving toward verse 5, mind of Christ. We got just a couple of minutes left. How do you want to navigate to this mind of Christ?
Yeah, well, and going back to that.
And we can do another video as well, which is fine.
And going back to that term abuser or even a narcissist, what the world is describing is someone who's not Christ-like. The problem is they don't have Christ in their wheelhouse as far
right.
as philosophy, as far as anthropology, epistemology, etc. And so what they're doing is saying, we see something incredibly wrong here. You know, that moral law that Romans 2 talks about that's written on our heart, We're seeing that a person is not Christ-like. They're not being Christ-like to someone else. And so what does that look like? And in Philippians chapter 1 gives us a short list there of things that Christ provides for us. If we are in Christ, we're receiving comfort, right? We're receiving encouragement. We're receiving a participation by God Himself in us. And we quickly find there's unity, not just with God, but with others.
Right.
And we see that biblically throughout Scripture of people walking with God where even their enemies accepted them. And so what we're describing as an abuser really is someone who's antithetical to Christ. And so our mission is to give them the gospel and let the Holy Spirit, again, change them. Now, there's no guarantee. We can't make them. We don't know what's going to happen in that counseling session. So there's no guarantee. You know, we're not trying to salvage marriages. We're not trying to, recast someone's heart. We can't do that.
Right.
And again, that is so essential to what we're doing here. We're presenting them the gospel and allowing Christ to change that. You've counseled enough marriages, and you yourself have been married. I'm married. We know that this is a constant struggle for every marriage. It's
right.
a constant struggle for every parent, because we all have selfish ambitions, and we have proud thinking in how we parent. We have proud thinking and selfish ambitions in our covenant of marriage. And so this is a constant battle. We're constantly battling this. Are we going to be Christ-like, or are we going to serve ourselves?
So we'll wrap up here. Philippians 2 then gives us a beautiful picture of what this person should be like, and we want to present that picture to them and see what the problem is. Now, it could be the person is not regenerated, that they haven't been transformed initially. It could be that they are and they're captured by something, but you want to get into a granular level of identifying what these things are and presenting that to them as you trust the Spirit of God will bring the conviction, the transformation that the person needs.
Yeah, and I guess just as you were talking there, going through the rest of Philippians, which is so essential, we get a glimpse into the mind of Christ. As he's going to the cross, he humbled himself and became obedient to death. So the opposite of an abuser, if you would, is someone who's laying down their life for those that they have, you know, don't even necessarily need to. In the case of Christ, they shouldn't be, and yet he's doing that. And so If you think about it this way, an abuser is someone who's using others to fulfill their selfish ambition versus using their life to advance towards Christ and towards a good place, if you will, because advancing towards Christ is good, others. And so the difference is using people or advancing people in what our ambition is, if you would.
And, yeah, and that's why I like the term unchristlike as an accurate descriptor for what you are seeing, because when you call it unchristlike, it's easier to identify what's happening. Honestly, it's easier to communicate to the individual what they are doing,
right?
And you're presenting the alternative to them while you are describing what they're doing from a biblical perspective. We're talking about abuse. If you have any questions, you're welcome to put them in the comment section of this video. We'll have some additional links on abuse. We have a lot of material available for you. Also, if you have a topic that you want us to cover, if you put that in the comment section, we would love to consider it. Thanks so much for watching the video.